Hi guys. So we have now talked about algorithms quite a lot, and our next goal is to talk about the complexity of algorithms, because we are going to be getting more and more interested in algorithms that are hard versus algorithms that are easy, or rather problems that are hard and problems that are easy, in the sense that we have a hard problem would be a problem for which we don't have very fast algorithms. And an easy problem or a good problem is one where we have good algorithms, fast algorithms. But how do we measure fast? How do we say that something is a good algorithm that works fast or not? And the reason that we're also interested in this is, at least for this, there are many, many reasons, of course, that we're interested in this. But for one of the reasons that we will see later also is that the hard problems, the ones that are not easy to solve, or at least up to now, we don't know how to do it quickly. Has to do with the state of knowledge. But our state of knowledge for some problems we'll see is that we currently they're very hard, and because they're hard, we can use them for cryptographic purposes. And we will all discuss all this. But that's going to take a while. That's basically the aim for the rest of the course where we're going to. We will have to do other stuff because these algorithms will involve some arithmetic that we still have to study. So there's quite a lot that is still on the menu. But just to give you an idea where we're going. And so today we will address the question, what is the growth of a function? So how can we compare functions? Because if you have ever graphed a function using graphic calculator in pre-calculus in Calc 1, you notice that some functions are steep and others are less steep, right? Just a simple example, this would be a line, this would be a parabola, and this would be the logarithm. So you see that the logarithm is going up very slowly. It goes up all the way to infinity. It doesn't have an asymptote, although it looks a little bit the way I draw it, but it keeps growing. The logarithm of n, if n goes to infinity, is infinity. And each of these functions has this, so this is y equals... Sorry, I have to write it here. Y is equal square. This is y equals x. And this is y equal log of s, or ln of x. So if you compare, you see this goes very slow. This goes at a steady rate. And this actually goes faster than this one. So these functions for us will have different growth rate, or different speed. They represent different speeds. There is another one that I should put in this list. I'll give you a bit more complete list a bit later, but this is the exponential function, e to the x. Now, since I have to draw everything, I cannot make it dramatically so, but you should try to see if you put on a 10 by 10 an exponential, a screen of 10 by 10 on your calculator, graphing calculator, an exponential function versus, say, y equals x squared, a parabola, you see the exponential kind of very quickly goes off of your screen up because it grows way, way faster than an x squared. As I said, we only see a very small part where we don't really see the effect of that. Good. But that's just what we see, what we feel, what we understand. We have been using this, I don't know, in Calc 1 or Calc 2 when we calculate limits, we talked about dominant terms. The higher degree term is a dominant term. An exponential is more dominant than a polynomial. That things that came up in estimating limits at infinity. But how do we formalize this? And there is one formal definition which is, I'm going to give it to you, but it's not really something that we're going to work too much with because it is technical. And we are interested in understanding this concept and using it rather than studying the mathematics of the concept. So let me get rid of a little bit of this picture here. So the definition is this. We say that this big O here, that is going to be our big guy, and it's a curly O or a round O. I'm going to write as a curly O. In the book, it's a round big O. But this is what people call it. They call it the big O. It's a bit silly name, but that's what it's called. And it says it is a way of comparing a function. You say f, a function f of x. So we have now f and g are functions from the reals to the real, say. You might be a little bit surprised that we all of a sudden talking about real functions because this is discrete math. Eventually, we're really going to have functions that actually just defined on the integers. So this this works for real to real, but we often only have functions from the natural numbers to the reals, and very often these are functions from the natural numbers to the natural numbers. So these are this is the most general case, and these are special cases of these functions. You have to understand it that way. And that's how we're going to take this. And so, we say, one way of saying that, I'm going to express what it means that f is big O of g. So we have f and g, and I say the function f is big O of g. Is supposed to mean, so this should mean that g dominates f. So it's the other way around of f. F is dwarfed by g, if you want to read it. So f is big O of g means that f is dwarfed by g, but that's perhaps a little bit too strong. What we really want to say, eventually we will mean, but often, and I'm going to explain why I'm saying should mean and often, but often means grows almost in the same way as, so means that f grows almost in the same way as g. In other words, they are kind of similar in growth. And then we will discuss this. Let me give you the definition. Now, let's focus on this. I'm going to come back to this more general meaning, which is actually what the definition will give. But I will then tell you why we say often means. Okay. So, but let's try to get this. F grows almost in the same way as G. Well, what we would say is, well, if F is less than G, right? Then that would kind of say this, but it actually even says this. G dominates F because G is just bigger than F. Now, okay, there are a couple of things that we should think of. First of all, imagine a function like this. Suppose F looks like this. F is this. And this is G. So this is F, and this is G. Now, which one do you think is the fastest one? Which one grows faster? Which dominates? G, right? That's clearly going up. I mean, we don't know yet what's happening, but now assume that the pattern continues kind of, you imagine the pattern. Notice that F has this weird kick here. Why am I doing this? Because in the beginning, F is actually on top for a long while. F is bigger than G, but then eventually G says, oh, you know, I'm much faster than you. So in other words, it takes G a little bit longer to get up to speed, but once it's up to speed, it's going to beat it. Okay? So, which one do you think is the biggest? G, right? But then, this is no longer true, because it's not true that fx is always smaller than g of x. Here, the x's that are in this range here, these x's, is false. So, what we really want is, well, eventually. So, I'm going to write it like that, eventually. Which means, for x is big enough, i.e., it means for x big enough. And what does that mean? Big enough means bigger than a certain number. Say for x going from 10 onwards. From x going 10 onwards, from then onwards, g is always bigger than f. Okay. What about negative functions? It can happen. And look, let's look at the picture here. This is my f, and this is my g. Now, it's true that g is not growing. It's declining. It's descending. But it's going much faster than f. It's still doing this in a much more impressive way than f does. So we would really want to think of g here being as the dominant guy here. Although he makes everything negative, that's just a little mistake he makes. He should make everything positive. So we should take absolute values. So, okay, I'm going to do that. Okay. And now I have to make one more addition. Because look at this. Okay, so let's take the parabola. This is f, and let's call this g, actually. I'm going to call this g, and I'm going to take a same parabola here, f, but I shift it a little bit. Now, it is true that wherever I go, g will go this, and f will be this. So actually, g will be always smaller than f. But it will never, the distance between them, suppose this was 0 and this was 3, at any rate, the distance is going to be 3. Because the equation for g, what is the equation for g? Y is x squared. What is the equation for f? If you remember this from an older thing, shifting is just adding 3. No, that's not shifting. That is shifting it up. I'm sorry. Y is x minus 3 cube. So what does this now mean? So which one should be the dominant one here? Okay, f is bigger. I grant you that, but it's kind of just g, but he just started a little bit earlier, but then they both go the same speed, basically, right? If you think of this as somehow speed. So I should not really discount g here as being at least as big. And remember, this is where I'm going. G almost in the same way as g. So to get to this almost the same, I have to somehow modify this. And the trick is a little bit weird. I'm going to multiply this here with a constant. I'm saying I can put any constant I want here to make this happen. So in other words, a constant is a certain scaling. Multiplying with a constant means I'm scaling this a little bit. So if I scale this, in other words, in this case, it's actually a move, but in general, it will be a scale. If I scale g to be 3 times as big, if I replace g by y equals 3x squared, then you will see we get something like that. And they both start off going similar. It's not entirely the same, but you get similar growth. So this is the official definition. But I'm going to show you one calculation like this. But before I do this, let's look at simple functions. Let's look at the function that I had before here. Let's look at x squared plus x plus 1. Okay, it has 3 components. It has an x squared, that is the parabola, that is the y is x squared. It has this linear term, so let's also write from the linear term, and then we have the constant term. What does that look like? That's a constant line, right? So ignoring now this function itself, so this is the function f that I want to study. Let me look first at each of the components of each of the terms of this function. So this is y equals 1. Which one is the fastest here? It's clearly x squared, right? So if I list the how fast is everything, y, so what we see here that 1 is big O of x squared. Remember, what does this mean? It means that 1, let's think of it just what it's supposed to mean rather than the actual definition, but we will get to the actual definition in a little bit, dominates, okay? X squared dominates 1. It clearly does. Look at this, and 1 is going nowhere. X is O x squared, because you see here that this guy really dominates X. It's actually always, it's always positive, always above it. So it really dominates it. What about X squared? Well, yeah, of course, you dominate yourself, right? You kind of, well, now we're, instead of dominating, which sounds like Trump, but it is not, dominating means is as dominant as, is as fast as. So G is as fast as F. So we should perhaps read it that way. So V grows almost in the same way as F grows almost in the same way as G. Sorry, it got a little bit here in the picture gone. Let me see what I can get rid of these things. Yeah, so in the same way as g. That's kind of the intended meaning. And so, of course, x squared is in the same way as x squared. It's just itself. Okay. So, what can I now say? Now, remember, I can have this constant, right? And so, now what I want to say is that f is big O of x squared. Each of the terms are big O of x squared. Now, how do I, if I add these terms, I would have one contribution of this, one contribution of this, and one contribution of this. So what we really have here going on, if you just look at the inequalities here, so that 1 is less than x squared, eventually. Now, remember eventually, right? Because it's actually not really true. Always. Look at these two functions, these the parabola, the two curved, the two y is x and y, the linear and the parabola, are both below 1 in the beginning. But eventually, so this is eventually, I'm going to write it like that. Same for x. X is less than x squared eventually. And also, of course, x squared is less than x squared. So if I add them up, then get that x squared plus x plus 1 is less than x squared plus x squared plus x squared. 3 times x squared. And this is where the coefficient 3 is so nice. This says, okay, if you have this inequality, but you have this extra annoying factor here, constant factor, then you can just ignore this factor. And therefore, you can say this has the same O as that. Okay, and that is what I'm trying to say. Okay, I don't want to say too much more about this. The book spends a lot of time on it. There's a lot of questions on it, and perhaps other instructors delve much deeper into this problem. But I think for us, it's important to understand what is big O in different situations means. The first thing we should notice from what is here is that if f is a polynomial of degree d, then f is O of x to the power d. F grows as the highest power of d. That is the whole purpose of when you do it in calculus, when you were calculating limits infinity, you divide by the highest degree term, right? That's exactly why. Because the highest degree term is the dominant term. It is because f is almost like Oxd. Another way of thinking about this, it's not exactly correct, but is suppose that you would graph these two functions, this polynomial and this polynomial, this general polynomial degree d, and this x to the d. Now, remember, we should, since we are taking absolute values, it could be that the polynomial goes off to negative infinity, but to take an absolute value to make a polynomial that goes off to infinity. So, like a cubic polynomial would look something like this. This might be a cubic polynomial, whereas x cubed would go is this function. But the point is that if you would zoom out and imagine you look at a huge grid like for x going from 0 to a million in both, or from 0 to a quadrillion or so, and something like that, then you see these two graphs, but they're almost indistinguishable. Then in this huge picture, there's no difference anymore between them. So if you zoom out, they are kind of the same. And that is what this big O tries to capture. Okay. So this is for polynomials of degree d. Now, it is true. Okay, so I want to come back now a bit about this. So this is exactly what we found here, a polynomial of degree 2. It is Ox squared. Now, the definition allows you to say that f is also Ox cubed, because x cubed is a bigger power than x squared, right? So here we are then emphasizing that dominating part, right? So x cubed dominates x squared, true. But in general, when we use these things, when people, scientists or computer scientists, use this O, big O, then they actually mean this. Now, the book makes a distinction between it and says, okay, this, meaning the same, almost the same growth, that should be used as big theta, not a big O. And big theta looks like this. It's a big O with a stripe through, because that's how a Greek theta looks like. Sometimes they put extra things like that in there. But I'm saying, okay, you're right. Mathematically, you're right. But I haven't seen any paper on cryptography, on computer science, complexity of functions, where they use this. Because the idea is this. If I'm going to publish a paper, okay, it is an old, difficult problem, this particular F, that is the number of steps that this algorithm takes, how fast does it grow? And I'm going to write, I found out that it is O of n cubed. and I'm going to publish this paper. If I'm not giving the best solution that I can give, namely O n cubed, that it actually is O n squared, everybody that reads the paper says, oh, but silly goose. It's O n squared, not O n cubed. You can do better. Of course, my paper is, somebody else is going to publish a paper that said, okay, this guy thought it was O n cubed, but it's much better than that. It's O n squared. And that guy published a paper with the O n squared, and there goes my paper. Nobody wants to read it. They say, well, that's old stuff that you're talking about. So you when you use this O notation, you kind of try to use it optimally, and so that you almost, your intention at least is, well, the function that I'm studying is almost like n squared, and nothing more complicated than or nothing smaller. Otherwise, I would say it if it's smaller, right? I would tell you. Now, it's, as I said, so it is good for practical purposes to allow to do this, but we never do this. Now, here's a picture of, I'll try to enlarge it a little bit, this from the textbook, of a couple of functions. Now, as I said, this theory for big O works for any function from the reals to reals, but we are going to work, discrete math, functions from the natural numbers to the natural numbers. And so from now on, instead of x, I'm going to write n's. And so here are a couple of functions, the constant function. Here's the n that we took out, n squared we have talked about. Now, remember, I told you about the exponential function, and that is much faster. Now, on this scale, you can... Well, this is, by the way, this is not... This scale is not the same as this scale. This actually is a logarithmic scale. So on a logarithmic scale, this is much faster going... Here, the distances are not equidistant. Notice from 1 to 2 and then from 2 to 4 seems to be the same distance. So this is actually a logarithm scale. I don't know whether you have ever looked in this in other courses, but it's not a usual XY system. So it gives a little bit of a distorted picture. But still, even in this distorted picture, you still see that this is the dominant one over this one. And the point is, they are really strictly dominant. It's not that in the case of when I said here, let's go to this statement here. So get back to the good statement that this is O of x squared, right? And this meant that this function f is almost the same as x squared. Therefore, I can also say that x squared is O of f, this f. But nobody in his sane mind does this. When we use the O notation, we're going to use only very basic functions like the powers of x. And so here in this picture, you have the powers of x here. We have this is the zero power, first power, second power. The other powers are not shown here, but they are all somewhere in this range. And so they are all different. So an n squared is different than an n cubed. N cubes go faster than n squared, so we should distinguish them. But notice also, so the exponential, as I said, is going faster. Now, the bigger the base, the bigger the faster the exponential goes. So 3 to the n would go this way, 4 to the n, they go much faster and faster. Notice there's another function that you have also probably seen in calculus and all places like that. So remember, n factorial is n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 all the way times 2 times 1. It's the product of the first n numbers. I wrote it from big to small, but perhaps you rather route it from small to big. But again, the order in which you multiply is not important. So for instance, 6 factorial is 6 times 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. That is 30, 120, 720. So you see, even for input 6, you already get a rather big number, 720. And this is what this picture tries to show, is that n factorial is way, way faster than any of these functions that we have. Now, I want to also pay attention to the other one, log n, which is the inverse, inverse function of 2 to the n, log with base 2 here. So let's concentrate with log base 2. There's a difference between different logs, but there's actually no difference between the two logs. I'll say something about that later. But so it looks like the log, which is the inverse of this, since this goes fast, remember, how do you find the inverse function? Do you remember this? If you have a function... say this is the function. How do you find the inverse of this function? So what is the inverse? That means y is fx is the function where the role of y and x are switched. So where x becomes the output and y is the input, and this amounts to switching y and x, amounts to taking the reflection of the function along this dotted axis here, and so it would be look something like that. That would be the how the inverse of a function looks like. So this would be f inverse, not the reciprocal. Be very careful. F minus 1 is the inverse, which is not the same as the reciprocal. That is 1 over f. I know this minus 1 is a very bad notation, but it is something that we have for centuries that we have been using this, and so it's now very hard to get rid of. So when we write arc tangent of x, that's what I prefer, but very often textbooks write it as tangent minus 1 of x, and every calculator has tangent minus 1 of x. This is not the reciprocal of tangent. What is the reciprocal of tangent? Cotangent. Why would we have a new notation for it if that would be just the reciprocal of tangent? No, it is a different function. It is the function that you get by flipping over along the diagonal. So this is what you can, well, you can see it on this picture because it's a logarithmic scale and not an usual xy scale, but still. But as you can imagine, if this is a fast-growing function, by flipping it over, I make it, if this is a faster-growing function, by flipping it over, I make it a less fast-growing function. This is exactly what happens. Log n is slower than n. It is, of course, faster than a constant. So we here already see a little bit of hierarchy. The constant, that is really, a constant is a constant, right? That means a function that doesn't grow. This is the logarithm, is one of the slowest growing functions. Then we have n, which is faster. Then, because log n is faster, is less fast than n, n times log n is less fast than n squared. I will come back to this, why this is true in general, but you can imagine, just looking in the picture. So we get here a little bit of, and these are kind of, often, you see, many complexities are a bit of this type. Some of them are of this type. And that's where we're going to talk about next time. But this is already a scale where we log n is considered better, faster than n, which is considered faster than n log n, which itself is again considered faster than n squared. Now, you might be a little bit saying, why? Well, imagine an input of, say, a million, of 1,000. Let's do 1,000. The log of 1,000 with base 2 is about 10. This is about 1,000, okay? So this is about product 10,000, okay? Big, but what is this? A million. This is way, 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 way bigger, you see? And I hope I don't have to tell you that 2 to the power 1,000 is an enormous number. You know how many digits it has? Probably something like 100 digits or something like that, okay? And 1,000 factorial? Don't even start about it. It's an enormous big number. Far from the biggest number that we know, but it is still a very big, big number. So just on values like n at 1,000, and that's very reasonable values in computer science. I mean, we were going to apply this to problems of size 1,000, even problems, data banks of size 1,000,000. It's a big difference if you have a log of 1,000,000 or 1,000,000 or n times log of 1,000,000, 1,000,000 times the log of 1,000,000, or 1,000,000 squared. And that's the whole point. Okay, so what I have to tell you now, so we have seen a couple of, this n factorial here, let me make this back to a normal size, n factorial is, it's not something that we like to use as comparison, and this is sometimes when sometimes says n factorial is O of n to the power n. So both the base as the exponent are variable n here. And why is this? Well, remember n factorial, that is n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 all the way to 2 times 1. Each time you start with n, subtract from it, multiply with it, subtract from it, multiply what you have, and so on. So, of course, this is less than n. Well, that is equal to n. This guy, n minus 1, is less than n. This is less than n, right? You see, each of these terms is less than n. Of course, here it becomes rather trivial that they're less than n because they're very small. Now, how many of those guys have I here? Well, n. There are n numbers, right? N factors. So this whole thing, if I would multiply this whole thing, we see that n factorial is less than n to the n. And that is why we can say this. But truthfully, n factorial slows grower than. It's not really O n of n to the n. Now, not that we're going to run into that so much, but this is an interesting, what is the log of n factorial? How does that grow? Well, So log of n factorial is log of O n to the n. So what I'm trying to say now is, if you have a continuous function, what is that? I don't care about it. Logarithm. If you take a logarithm of something, of something, then if you take the, if a function has a certain growth rate, this we call, instead of saying n factorial is all n to the n, we say n factorial has growth rate n to the n. So as we say that this polynomial, so another way of saying big O is that, where's my polynomial here? This polynomial has growth rate x square. It's the same as saying O x square. So this is another way, it should mean g dominates, and it means almost grows in the same way, or we say that f has growth rate of g. But these g's here are now very special functions. They are powers of x, or logarithms, or a power of x times a logarithm, or like the ones that occur in this little chart here. There are more, of course, but you can imagine what type they are. So so if I now take the logarithm of the growth rates, then it goes through. This is the same as O of the log of n to the n. But what is that? That is O of n log n. This is the rules of logarithm. The logarithm of a power, the exponent comes down, right? This is equal to that by the rules of logarithm. And this is now very reasonable, O of log n log n. And so logarithm of n factorial grows as fast as O n log n. Okay, so what else? What else can we say? Well, if we have to take, if O of f plus g is O of the max of f and g. O of f times g is O of f times O of g. Okay, let me explain what I mean here. The first one I didn't write correctly. Let me write it. I said it. It's better to write it. This is the max of OF and OG. The first one we have actually seen, but I'll give you an example. So suppose you have to calculate the O of x cubed plus x fifth. Well, x cubed, that has O x cubed, obviously. Well, let's make, put some numbers here. 4x. 2x cubed has the same growth rate as x cubed. Remember, a factor doesn't matter here. That's part that's built in into the definition. So 2x cubed has the same growth rate as ox cubed. 4x to the fifth has the same growth rate as ox to the fifth. So what is the growth rate of this one? Okay, that is, I could have written it with an equal sign, right? So perhaps I should write it here with equal signs. It is just the product of these two. So it is O of x cubed. I don't know where my product came from. We're adding here things. What am I talking about? Adding. So how do you calculate the growth rate of these two? Well, this is about the maximum. So let me fill that in here in the formula. So this is the max of two numbers, O of x cubed and O of x to the fifth. Well, two growth rates, sorry, not two numbers. And this is, of course, the smaller, so this is the greater. So this is O x to the fifth. Now, this already conforms with what we said, right? The growth rate of a polynomial is the highest degree. So that's how it works with the sum. How does it work with a product? Well, suppose, what is the growth rate? Here, let me now do a little bit more. X cubed plus log of x times x squared plus plus 4x. Let's estimate this one. Well, we can estimate the growth rate of this guy, and we can estimate the growth rate of this guy, and then multiply. That's what it says. Now, what is the growth rate of x cubed plus log x? Now we are dealing with a sum. So we should now compare. This is the maximum of the growth rate of x cubed and the growth rate of log of x. Now, which one do you think is the biggest? This one, right? Because we already know that O of log x in from our picture is even smaller than x itself, right? Here is log of x is smaller than x or n, okay? So definitely smaller than the cube. So the maximum is going to be that one. What about in the second one? So O of x squared plus 4x, that's the max of O of x squared and O of x because the 4 doesn't count here. And we know already, well, we know that the growth rate of a polynomial is the biggest degree. So this, sorry, this is O of x cubed. This is O of x squared. So what is then this? Well, now we're taking a product. We have found the O of this function. We found the O of this function. By the product here rule, this is O of x squared times x cubed, which is O of x to the fifth. Okay. Okay. So that's how things work. So let me do one example here. This is, let's look at the function 3n log n factorial plus n squared plus 3 log n. So this is kind of a question that I could ask you. When I do a quiz about this, this is the type of thing I'm going to ask you. What is the growth rate of this function? Okay, so first of all, it's a sum. So this means we have to find the growth rate of this guy and we have to find the growth rate of that guy. Now let's talk first about the first one. Well, we have 3, which is a constant, which doesn't matter. So 3n, really. And we know that the growth rate of that is n. What about log n factorial? We have discussed this. Remember, log of n factorial is, I'll write it again here, log of n, this is what we calculated here, right? Log of n factorial has this growth rate. So, let's see. This has growth rate O of n, this term. This guy has growth rate O of n log n. That's what we had calculated above there. So, what is the growth rate of this product? So, the growth rate of the product is the product of these two functions, n squared log n. Right? This is, so I'm using here the product rule, right? So it says that if you have to take the max, you take the product of the O of the O's here. Here, right? Okay. And the product of the O's is the product of the inside. You take the, in other words, O goes through the product. Let's make it very simple. O goes through the products. Okay, so we get this. Clear? Okay. Now we have again a product here. So what is the growth rate of this factor? Well, that's a polynomial. We know that it has growth rate the highest degree. And this is just on its own. This has growth rate log n. So what is the growth rate of this guy? Well, again, we take the product of these two, n squared log n. And now what's the growth rate of the whole thing? The maximum of both. Ah, but they both have the same, so the maximum is that. So in total, this is O n squared log n. So let me change the answer to see the slightly different thing. I'll do it in red. Suppose instead of a 3n, we had a 3n square here. This would become O n squared. So this would become O n cubed, right? Now, which one is the bigger? Well, now it would be this guy is bigger. So this would be the maximum. Remember, because this is a sum, and in a sum, we take the maximum. When it's a product, we take the product. When it's a sum, we take a maximum. So be a bit careful with that, right? Okay, that's what I wanted to say. Then, as I said, the textbook talks about big omega and big theta, which I'm not going to talk about. I don't think it's something that we should worry us too much about. What I want you to see is that quickly recognize the big O of certain functions that are a little bit have to be put together. We will see a lot of examples in the next chapter, next section, when we talk about complexity of algorithms. Then we're going to use this all the time. So for now, I'm going to leave you with what I introduced here. It's less than the textbook gives, but I'll make sure that the homeworks are addressing only the things that I discussed, perhaps here and there a little bit that you need extra, you need to read. And then we can apply this in our next lecture.